Okay, can you hear me? Everything okay? Okay, good. So I'd like to welcome you to this second lecture, second out of six, on approximate dynamic programming. Last time we talked about exact dynamic programming. First, finite horizon problems over n stages, and then infinite horizon problems over an infinite number of stages. And we focused on discounted problems, and we are going to review this discounted infinite horizon formulation. And I introduced some shorthand notation. And then after we do this review, we're going to focus on algorithms for exact discounted DP, value iteration, various forms of policy iteration, one particular type of policy iteration, which I call optimistic, which is going to come up again in the future. Then I'm going to talk about Q factors and Q learning, an introduction to these. We're going to revisit them later as well. Then we're going to talk about various models other than discounted. In this short course, we're going to focus almost exclusively on discounted problems, which are the easiest class of problems. They give you the strongest results. Other models may not have as strong results, but the discounted problems provide a benchmark of the best that you can achieve, and it's a good starting point for us, and we're going to follow that. But we are going to introduce some other dynamic programming problems, including some that are of continuous space and continuous time. Then we are going to close this overview of exact dynamic programming with a couple of more advanced topics. The first has to do with a more abstract view of dynamic programming that allows us to develop the theory simultaneously and in a unified way for all these models, not just for discounted, but for all of them, and look in a more fundamental way as to whether and as to why some results hold for some models and not for others. The last topic I want to touch upon briefly is asynchronous algorithms, where you either have a parallel computing system executing value or policy iteration, or you have a simulation-driven algorithm where not all states are treated at the same time. There's a certain asynchronous character to these algorithms, and it turns out that they work. Both policy iteration and value iteration, when appropriately implemented, they work in a synchronous format. So that's where we're going, and we're going to start with a review. Remember, in infinite horizon, in an infinite horizon setting, we have a stationary system which gives you the next state at time k plus 1, given the current state, the control that you apply, and a random quantity, which we call disturbance or noise or whatever you want to call it. It operates starting from 0, going to 1, 2, and so on, an infinite number of stages. At each stage, there is a cost that is incurred that depends on state control and this disturbance. Now, we are looking at policies. Policies are sequences of functions. One function for each time stage, and this function maps states into controls. So we observe the state, and the control function is a rule that tells us what control to apply. So we are looking for sequences of such feedback control functions, this mu 0, mu 1, and so on. Now, once we plug in such a policy into the cost function, which, by the way, is discounted by alpha, which is less than 1 in a discounted problem, then we get a random number. All these discounted costs added up over an infinite number of stages give you a random number, random because they depend on these W's here. We take the expected value over these W's and the limit as n goes to infinity, and we get a number which is the cost of policy pi starting at initial state x0. So for one state, I have one cost. For another state, I have a different cost, and so on. So this j pi is a function of the state into the real numbers. Now, one assumption that's critical for these discounted problems, in addition to the fact that alpha is less than 1, is that the cost per stage is bounded. In other words, there is a number m that provides an upper bound to the absolute value of the cost for any x, u, and w. The effect of this, the mathematical effect of this, is that it makes this series here summable, summable to a real number, okay? Because g is bounded, alpha k is geometrically going to 0, and the whole series is convergent to a real number, so j pi is a real valued function. Okay. Of course, there are some other implications, which I'm going to get into that, for this assumption of boundedness. But let me first remind you of the shorthand notation that I introduced for dynamic programming mappings. Now, we are dealing here with functions of state. And the dynamic programming algorithm, both for finite horizon and also its infinite horizon version, takes functions and produces other functions. Now, these other functions are denoted by tj. So t is a box, some abstract box, that takes a function and produces another function through this operation. Now let me review this operation for you. It involves, at state x, the first stage cost and the cost from the next state onward as measured by the function j that we are operating on. This expected value is a number minimize over all u, and that gives you the value of tj's of x. It is the optimal cost for a one-stage problem involving this one-stage cost plus a cost to go, a final cost at the end of the stage. Okay? Now, this is the mapping. This is dynamic programming. Dynamic programming starts with some j, produces tj, t squared j. T squared j is t applied on tj. T cubed j, which is t applied on t squared j, and so on. And so clearly, it's a very important operation, and it turns out to be very fundamental as well. So that's the notation, and it's much better to work with this expression than with that expression. It can get pretty complicated. Okay, now suppose that you have a fixed policy, mu. And let's say the policy is stationary. Stationary policies are very important here. Stationary policies are pi's for which mu does not change. The same mu at time 0, same mu at time 1, and so on. So a stationary policy is mu, 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 okay? And if you plug it in here for a given j, it gives you another function, t mu of j. This is the one-stage cost of applying mu at the first stage and then getting a terminal cost associated with j. Okay. So these two are similar, but this is for a single policy, and this is for all policies, the minimum overall policies. Okay, so this is the shorthand notation, and the nice thing about the shorthand notation, it gives you the possibility to describe the entire theory of these problems in a couple of slides. So this is the shorthand theory. Bellman's equation, j star, the optimal cost function that we're looking for, satisfies this equation. J star is equal to tj star. It says that j star is a fixed point of the mapping t. More analytically, it's this equation here. This equation is one equation for each state, okay? So this is a functional equation, an equation satisfied by the whole function j star, okay? So if you have, if x takes a finite number of values, if there are only a finite number of states, 1 up to n, there are n equations here, j stars of 1, j star of 2, and so on. So this becomes a vector equation, but generally it's a functional equation. And this equation is is for J star, and there's another equation for J mu. And we showed last time that J star is the unique solution of this equation, whereas J mu, for any stationary mu, is the unique solution of this equation. That's the first fundamental result. The second result is that if I give you J star and you minimize in this expression here and get a policy in this way, then this policy is optimal. Okay, it's an optimality condition. Find J star and then minimize in this expression, or equivalently, find mu such that T mu at J star equals Tj star. If you find such a mu, then it's optimal. Conversely, if you have an optimal mu, then it must satisfy this equation. This is an if and only if condition. The third major result is about the method of value iteration. Value iteration starts with J, any J that is bounded, generates Tj by applying this mapping here, with the T mapping, then generates T squared J, T cubed J, and so on. In the limit, value iteration has the property that it converges to the optimal value function. It's a major algorithm for calculating J star. And of course, we want to calculate J star because this will also give us optimal policies. So we proved this convergence last time, or almost proved it. And there's a second major algorithm, policy iteration, which we described, but we did not show its validity last time. In policy iteration, instead of generating cost functions, J, Tj, T squared J, and so on, we generate policies. We start with some policy mu zero, and then generate another policy mu one, another policy mu two, and so on. So here's the typical iteration of policy iteration. Given a stationary policy mu k, we find the cost of that policy. And this cost is obtained as a fixed point of the mapping t mu. This is called policy evaluation. So we solve this functional equation here for mu, for a given mu k, find j mu k, and then we find mu k plus 1 that satisfies this equation, in other words, attains the minimum in this expression when j star is replaced by j mu k. This is called policy improvement. Now, policy iteration and value iteration is going to be very important for us. Approximate versions of those are the heart and soul of approximate dynamic programming. So we're going to get back to them quite frequently. But for the moment, we have been looking at the exact versions. We showed convergence of this. In a few slides, we're going to look into this and show convergence of that as well. Okay. Now, what are the major properties that make the theory work? What is at the foundations of all the proofs and arguments and justifications? It turns out that the fundamental properties are embedded in these mappings T and T mu. The first major property is that both T and T mu, if I can take you back here, are monotone. If I increase J by a certain amount uniformly, from J I take it up by some amount, then Tj is also going to increase. Okay, it's evident because there's a plus sign here. Similarly, for T mu, it is monotone. So that's a property that's very, very basic and very important. Very simple, but still very important. For any functions j and j prime on the state space, one bigger than the other, then if you apply t to them, to both of them, the inequality is preserved. And similarly for t mu. Now, just about all dynamic programming models have this monotonicity property. It's part and parcel of the structure of these problems. However, for discounted problems, there's another very important property that is responsible for the good nature, good character of these problems. What makes discounted problems be relatively easy and having a strong theory is that in addition to monotonicity, there is a contraction property lurking in, which we have already discussed. And it says that for any bounded functions J and J prime, then the distance between J and J prime, as measured by this expression here, by the maximum distance between the two, this distance is reduced when you apply T to these two functions. Applying T to J and to J prime brings them closer in this sense by a factor alpha. Alpha, remember, is a discount factor less than one. Similarly, there's another property similar for mu, or for T mu, is we have this. And now if you want to translate it in even more compact notation, introduce a norm. Introduce a norm on the space of functions, J, which is the maximum magnitude, okay? So you have a function, take the maximum magnitude, and that's the norm of the function. And what, in terms of this norm, these properties here translate are equivalent to, in shorthand, to this, that the norm between J, Tj and Tj prime is less than alpha times the norm between J and J prime. In mathematical terms, this says that T is a contraction mapping on the space of functions J. And similarly, T mu is a contraction mapping. Now, contraction mappings have great properties, and that's why discounted problems also have great properties. Okay. All of this is review up to now. And let's go into the algorithms. One is value iteration. We discussed that. It works for any starting function J. And here's policy iteration. Given mu k, evaluate mu k. In other words, find its cost function by solving the corresponding functional equation, the Bellman equation corresponding to mu k. In shorthand, it is like this. In longhand, it is like this. Okay? Then after you calculate this cost function of mu k, you improve mu k by finding another policy, mu k plus 1, by minimizing in this expression. So notice you have already calculated j mu k. You plug it in here, and for every state x, you do this minimization, and you obtain a minimal, a control that attains the minimum, and that's your new policy. You can write this expression in longhand, or in shorthand, it's like this, as you can verify. So that's policy iteration. And now, before we go into justifying this policy iteration, let's make an observation. Suppose that you have n states, okay? Not n-dimensional system, n states, 1, 2, up to n. So there are n costs associated with j mu. J mu is a vector, j mu 1 at state 1, 2, and so on up to n. So this j mu is a vector. When you evaluate j mu using this equation, you need to solve a linear system of equations. There is one equation here for each x, so there are n equations with n unknowns, which are the components of this j mu k. And this is a linear equation. Why is it linear? Well, this is a constant term here. And this is a term which involves this expectation. Now, expectation is a linear operation, right? To write the expectation of a random variable, you just write the product, the weighted product of the values of the random variable with the corresponding probabilities. So this is a linear operation over here. So you have n linear equations with n unknowns, and you can write this system compactly like so. This is a vector equation involving this constant vector, involving this matrix here, alpha p mu, and p mu is the so-called transition probability matrix associated with mu. Let's not go into the details of that. It is the matrix that comes out from this equation. So you have a vector, j mu here, which is the unknown, another vector which is the unknown, and this is a linear equation, a matrix equation that you can solve by inversion. Okay? You solve the you invert the corresponding matrix and you get the solution in this way. So mathematically speaking, this is a very simple operation. The policy evaluation is a very simple operation. In practice, however, it's not so simple. And the reason is that if you have a large number of states, let alone if you have infinite number of states, even if you have a finite number of states, but if n is large, and I'm talking really large here, zillions and trillions and a huge number. Think of the hugest number that you can think, more than the number of molecules in the entire universe, a gigantic number. Then it is impossible to solve this equation by giving it to MATLAB, okay? You can't do that. The memory requirements are too big. The computational requirements are too big. So even though we are going to show shortly that this policy iteration terminates in a finite number of steps, applying it is out of the question. Applying it exactly. You can't apply it in practice. You have to do some kind of an approximation. Now, the type of approximation that we will use often, and I'm going to get into that later, is to solve this equation here iteratively, not exactly by matrix inversion, but iteratively, by using value iteration. Use value iteration to solve this equation approximately, with just a few iterations. Okay? So instead of solving it exactly, solve it approximately. And there are many, many kinds of approximations we can use, including solution by value iteration. Okay, so now what we would like to do is take a look at why this policy iteration method works. It turns out that the most important thing about it is that there is policy improvement. In other words, you have the current policy, mu k, you have its cost. The cost function of the next policy is better, is smaller. So it uniformly decreases the cost function with every iteration. And the proof of this is a few lines, which I'll give you here. What we want to show is that with every iteration, I get a cost function that's less than what I had before, a better policy. Now, I could get the two of them to be equal, but in that case, I will have an optimal policy. So I will show that either you have strict improvement at every iteration, or you have optimality. And here's the proof. For a given, okay, suppose we are at iteration k, then we know that the policy evaluation equation holds, j mu k satisfies this equation. When I minimize this expression here involved in t against j mu k, I get something that's smaller. And by policy improvement, I have that this is equal to that. Okay? So just from the definition of the method, I have that when you apply t mu k plus 1 to j mu k, it takes it down. So you start with j mu k, applying t mu k plus 1, I get something that's smaller, apply it again and again, get something smaller, and you get convergence to something. So that's due to the monotonicity property. J mu k is less than this here. Apply t mu k plus 1 again, and then again, and you get a monotonically decreasing sequence. And in the limit, you get, by value iteration, you get j mu k plus 1. So that's that. J mu k is greater than j mu k plus 1. It's two lines proof. OK, now if the two are equal, then equality holds throughout here, which which among others shows that J mu k solves Bellman's equation, the T equation, because it's a T somewhere here, I have equality here. Therefore, J mu k is equal to J star. So in the end, at iteration k, either the algorithm generates a strictly improved policy, strict inequality in at least one state, or else it finds an optimal policy. Now this is true for an arbitrary state space. If you have a finite spaces MDP or a finite state MDP, then the algorithm terminates with an optimal policy. Why is that? For a finite spaces MDP. Finite number of states, finite number of controls at each state. How many policies are there altogether? It's a finite number. Finite number of policies. At every iteration I have strict improvement or else optimality, therefore termination in a finite number of steps with an optimal policy. If you have an infinite state space, then you can show convergence asymptotic in an infinite number of iterations. That's a little trickier to show, but it is true. Okay. So this policy iteration method has very solid properties for the discounted problem. Okay. Now there is, we mentioned value iteration as one algorithm, and then policy iteration. And the fact that sometimes it's better to use a few iterations of a few value iterations to evaluate a policy rather than to evaluate it exactly, because we may have a very large number of states. This is called optimistic policy iteration. It is policy iteration where the policy evaluation is done approximately with a few iterations, with a few value iterations. So here it is. Optimistic policy iteration. This is policy iteration where the policy evaluation is done approximately with a finite number of value iterations. So we approximate J mu with a few value iterations involving mu, starting from any J. M can be 1, in which case it turns out that we get value iteration algorithm, or it could be 2, 3, any number. M equals infinity is exact policy iteration. So this optimistic this optimistic method is intermediate between the two extremes, value and policy iteration, and in practice it works better than both. And experimentally this has been verified, there's some analysis that indicates that, and you can think of extreme cases where it would be better than either one. It's not difficult to do that. There's a shorthand notation for this method. Since I'm big on shorthand notations, I have it here and you can see what it is. This is the policy improvement iteration, and this is the policy evaluation iteration involving mk number of value iterations. And for mk identical equal to 1, you can verify that it is exactly value iteration. For mk infinity, it becomes policy iteration. You can show convergence for both finite and infinite space discounted problems. In the case of, in both cases, both in finite and infinite, you can show an infinite number of iterations. You need an infinite number of iterations because for the special case where mk is equal to 1, it becomes value iteration. And value iteration requires an infinite number of iterations. Typically, it works faster than value iteration and policy iteration, particularly for large problems. When we are going to talk about approximations later and approximate policy iteration, it's always some kind of optimistic method that you are using. We never use the two extremes, or very seldom we use the extreme of value iteration and never exact policy iteration in approximate dynamic programming. Okay. Let's say one more thing about policy iteration with an eye to the future. Starting in the next lecture, we're going to be talking about approximations, and we're going to be talking about approximate versions of this policy iteration algorithm. So let's have a preview of that, and what's the basis for that? Okay, So where can we have approximations? There can be approximations in two ways. The policy evaluation may be approximate in the sense that instead of computing the cost of a policy, we compute some other function, jk, which is uniformly within delta. This is the maximum norm. So the maximum distance value distance between jk and j mu k is bound by delta. So I have this j mu k that I want to evaluate, but instead I'm using something that's within delta uniformly from that. Delta is some number, whatever it is. Okay, so this is approximate policy evaluation. And suppose also that the policy improvement is approximate. So when I take the minimum in the minimization operation corresponding to jk that I have gotten, I don't find the exact minimum, but rather something that's within epsilon of the minimum. So policy improvement is exact within epsilon. Okay? So both of these approximations, of course, throw off the convergence. You can't expect convergence to the exact optimum. But what you have is a bound. The bound says that the sequence of policies generated by this approximate policy iteration method satisfies this inequality. So these policies do not converge to anything that's optimal, but come to within this factor, this number, this bound, from the optimal. Okay, so the optimal is somewhere over here, and I get something that's higher than that, but by no more than this. Now, epsilon is what you, the approximation involved in the policy improvement. Delta is the approximation, the error involved in the policy evaluation. And there is a factor 1 minus alpha squared in the denominator. Alpha is the discount factor. This factor in the denominator is kind of worrisome, because alpha may be something like 0.99, okay, very close to 1. And this denominator is going to cause this bound to be very high. It turns out that you can find specialized examples where this inequality is sharp. Okay. However, typically in practice, this bound is conservative. What you get is you start out, typical behavior in practice, you start out with some initial policy, and you have some cost functions like that. Then you apply one step of approximate policy iteration. You get something that's lower and lower and lower, up until you get to within some zone from the optimum. And you get in there, you sort of bounce back, okay? The method does not converge, it just oscillates within this zone here. That's the typical behavior in practice. And this zone is not as high, it's not as big as this bound suggests. It is something typically smaller. There's another bound that I want to mention. If this sequence of policies terminates at some policy mu bar, in other words, you get to some point and you keep generating the same policy, it's not going to be optimal. It's going to be optimal within some error bound. And this error bound is this here. And it is better by a factor of 1 minus alpha than this other bound. There are some approximate policy iteration methods for which you can guarantee termination and have this better error bound. There are some others where you cannot guarantee termination. You get oscillation generically, and then this bound here that that is in effect. Now, you should not take these bounds too seriously, okay? They are not quantitative bounds that you can use. You can't, first of all, you cannot guarantee that you get, when you do approximate policy evaluation, who knows what this delta is? You can't get a hold on numerical value of delta. Similarly, you cannot get a hold on the numerical value of epsilon unless epsilon is equal to 0, okay? So since delta is unknown, you can't really say much about that's quantitative using these bounds. All you can say is that at least the method does not explode, does not go unstable. It's stable within some bounds, okay? It's not going to explode on you, which is not very much, but it's something. It's not quite negligible, okay? Because there are methods that do approximations, and then they explode over time. Okay, so that's a good point to take a little break. Are there any questions about policy iteration? We have done policy iteration so far, and now we're going to go into Q factors, and we have closed the subject for the moment of policy iteration, at least exact. And are there any questions? Yes.
Can we prove that a combination of a policy iteration and the value iteration can generate faster convergence? You mean that in practice it performs better? But is there any theoretical example?
Yeah, your question has to do with this optimistic policy iteration. Okay, I'm telling you that it typically works faster than value iteration and policy iteration, but can you prove it? The answer is that there are some partial results that you can interpret them as faster convergence. The most convincing evidence is really the practical evidence. The theoretical results are not so definitive. There are some, but they're not definitive. It's mostly based on practice. But it is a sure thing, okay? You have no doubt about it. Yes?
My understanding, if MK equals to 1, then it should be, I think it should be policy iteration. If
MK is equal an integer 1 or greater.
1.
Yeah.
In my understanding, they are reverse. If MK always equals to 1, I think it should be positive iteration. If MK equals to infinity, I think it
should be positive. I'm not sure I understand what you mean, it should be positive.
If MK equals to infinity, in my understanding, it should be value iteration. Why is positive?
Okay. No, I don't think you're right. Okay, your question is the following. Suppose that mk is equal to infinity. Then I claim that this relation here gives you, this relation gives you j mu k plus 1, okay? Because you do an infinite number of it, mk goes to infinity, so this sequence converges to j mu k. So this is exact policy evaluation. And therefore, when followed by policy improvement, you get the policy iteration. I think it's correct as it is. Okay.
I think in the last slide error. We implement the mu k policy.
Yes.
Yes. In the g function, here. Yeah. It's mu k x.
Ah, there's a typo here. There should be m k. Okay, you're right.
It's
m superscript k.
Yeah.
Yes, you're right. Yeah, it's a typo. I'll correct it. As was mentioned earlier, this slides change up to 5 minutes before the lecture. So sometimes there are some mistakes. And even though we are posting slides before the lecture for you to take a look at the end of the lecture, I make corrections to typos and post them again. OK, so let's take a break for 10 minutes, and then we'll come back and continue.